The Arctic is the northernmost region on Earth. There are many definitions of the Arctic itself, including the area above the Arctic Circle, the region where trees no longer grow, and where the average temperature in July is below 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 degrees Celsius. The Arctic Circle is one of two polar circles on Earth and is currently at 66 degrees, 33 minutes latitude, and represents the southernmost point. The sun can be above the horizon at local midnight during the June solstice, and below the horizon at local noon during the December solstice. This desolate region typically does not generate much public interest, as only about 4 million of the world's 7.5 billion people live there, and much of the Arctic is ocean covered by sea ice. However, due to a number of factors, including warming temperatures, untapped resources, scientific value, and geopolitics, the Arctic is poised to become a much more important place. At these high latitudes, many powerful countries are in very close proximity to one another, and some have long-standing differences. And while control of the landmass in the Arctic is mostly uncontested, the waters and the riches underneath are not. This century, the Arctic will take on new importance, but if the powers operating in the region do not cooperate, it will undermine opportunities that made the Arctic attractive in the first place. These opportunities include energy, minerals, transportation routes, tourism, and scientific research. Standing in the way of these opportunities are significant challenges that include geopolitical disputes, environmental concerns, and local opposition. There are 8 countries with territory in the Arctic. They are Russia, Canada, the United States, Denmark by way of Greenland, Iceland, Norway, Sweden, and Finland. Russia has the largest geographic and demographic presence in the region, with 1/5 of the landmass and 2/3 of the population. Also, an estimated 20% of Russia's GDP comes from the Arctic region, mostly from mining and natural gas. Despite being the biggest country in the Arctic, the others in the region have at best neutral relations with Russia. 5 are members of NATO and 3 are in the European Union. 3 of the countries, the US, Canada, and Russia, also have some of the largest economies in the world and play major roles on the world stage. With such influential countries operating in the Arctic, undoubtedly they will all vie for influence and work toward achieving their goals. Establishing ground rules for operating in the Arctic will be vital for cooperation and preventing conflict. As we will see, there are currently limited laws and treaties overseeing the Arctic. Like Antarctica, the Arctic has not been widely accessible for most of history. The inhospitable environment has made development very difficult, even today. However, unlike Antarctica, the Arctic landmass is controlled without much dispute by powerful and organized nation-states. The Antarctic landmass is partially claimed by several countries, but these claims are not widely recognized. Instead, Antarctica is considered to be shared by all of mankind. Another difference is that the Arctic contains an ocean surrounded by landmass, while Antarctica is landmass surrounded by ocean. In 1959, numerous countries signed the Antarctic Treaty, features of which include scientific freedom and a ban on military activity on the continent. In contrast, the Arctic does not have a comprehensive treaty system. The primary forum for cooperation is the Arctic Council, of which all 8 Arctic countries are members. In 2011, all 8 countries signed the Arctic Search and Rescue Agreement, giving each country a zone of responsibility for search and rescue. To date, this is the most significant diplomatic agreement specific to the region. The Arctic is home to extreme conditions, including very cold winters, but it is not the coldest place in the world, or even the Northern Hemisphere. Antarctica experiences much colder temperatures, and the coldest temperature ever recorded in the Northern Hemisphere was in Oymyakon, Russia, at 63 degrees north, below the Arctic Circle. The reason the Arctic does not get so cold is because it is mostly ocean. Even when covered by sea ice, ocean water cannot get colder than 28 degrees Fahrenheit or negative 2 degrees Celsius. The ocean water helps moderate the temperature at both sea and on Arctic coastal lands. Except for a small island between Canada and Greenland, there are no disputes over land in the Arctic. However, there are numerous overlapping claims to the ocean and seafloor in the region. The United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, which all Arctic countries except the United States are signatories to, establishes the legal boundaries in the ocean the countries can claim. There are four major boundaries defined by the agreement. Territorial waters, which extend 12 nautical miles from the coast, have numerous restrictions and are like an extension of a country's borders. With few exceptions, foreign vessels are not allowed to enter these waters unless it is a strategic waterway. We will see examples of these later. From 12 to 24 nautical miles off the coast, a country can still enforce customs, immigration, tax, and pollution laws. From 12 nautical miles to 200 nautical miles off the coast is a country's exclusive economic zone. In this area, they have exclusive rights to resources like fish, oil, and minerals. Foreign ships can transit these waters with fewer restrictions than territorial waters. If applicable, the fourth region is the continental shelf. If a country can prove its continental shelf extends beyond 200 nautical miles, it can extend its EEZ up to 350 nautical miles offshore. In the Arctic region, there are numerous overlapping claims relating to both EEZs and the continental shelf. Near the North Pole, Canadian, Danish, and Russian continental shelf claims all overlap. In 2007, Russian divers descended to the North Pole seabed, planted a Russian flag, and took soil samples. Russia has since claimed that these samples prove Russia's continental shelf extends to this region. The continental shelf disputes deal with subsurface resources, but there are also disputes near the coast over who and who doesn't control strategic waterways. With many countries having overlapping maritime claims, it is expected that military forces will be present in the region as well. Since the end of the Cold War, some military bases have been abandoned, but numerous installations are still in operation above the Arctic Circle. The Russians have the most bases in the Arctic, including the headquarters of its northern fleet at Kola Bay in the town of Severomorsk. The Canadian military base in Alert Nunavut is the northernmost permanently inhabited place on Earth. The American Thule Air Base in northern Greenland is the northernmost American military outpost in the world. It has early warning radars designed to detect nuclear ICBMs. Its real estate is also incredibly valuable, as it is as far from Washington, D.C. as it is from Moscow. An area where the U.S. military is severely deficient is icebreakers. The U.S. Coast Guard only operates two on the open ocean, the Polar Star and Healy. Polar Star, America's only heavy icebreaker, is mostly used in Antarctica, clearing a path to allow supplies to reach research bases on the continent. That often leaves the Healy alone in the Arctic. The disparity becomes more apparent when compared to Russia, which has over 40 icebreakers, including ones that are nuclear-powered. Icebreakers are very important assets as they can be used for scientific research, clearing a path for merchant ships, and search and rescue. With Arctic waters expected to become more navigable, but not completely ice-free, these icebreakers will be very important for commerce in the region. Current shipping routes from East Asia to Europe involve passing through the Strait of Malacca and transiting the Suez Canal to enter the Mediterranean. From East Asia to the U.S. East Coast, ships use the Panama Canal. These routes involve congested waterways and canal transit fees. Additionally, they are relatively indirect, causing ships to require a lot of fuel. And since the vast majority of global trade occurs by sea, a more direct route would help lower the cost of goods around the world. The Arctic might have that more direct route, at least for part of the year. Because the Arctic is warming, the extent of the sea ice is falling, potentially opening up a route through the Canadian archipelago called the Northwest Passage. If this route becomes available at a large scale, during the summer, ships could sail northeast through the Bering Strait, through the Northwest Passage, and south towards America or Europe. The Northwest Passage could save ships thousands of miles and thousands of fuel, while also not having to pay fees for the Panama or Suez canals. The reduced mileage is without question, but if Canada gets its way, ships will still pay fees for transiting the Northwest Passage. For the past few decades, a debate has been taking place about whether the Northwest Passage is an international waterway or a Canadian internal waterway. In international law, waterways that connect major bodies of water are considered to be international waters open to transit of ships from any country. Examples include the Strait of Gibraltar connecting the Atlantic and Mediterranean, the Turkish Straits of Bosphorus and Dardanelles connecting the Black Sea and the Aegean and Mediterranean Seas, and the Strait of Magellan in southern Chile that connects the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. Just as the Northwest Passage runs through Canadian territory, the Strait of Magellan is located in between Chilean territory. Canada says the Northwest Passage is an internal waterway and needs to raise revenue from it in order to build infrastructure like Coast Guard stations required to make the route safe for use. Many countries, including the United States, challenge this claim and regard the passage as international waters. This dispute has had flashpoints in the past, including in 1985 when the U.S. Coast Guard icebreaker Polar Sea sailed through the Canadian archipelago. In 2005, it is likely the USS Charlotte, a nuclear-powered attack submarine, traveled through Canadian Arctic waters en route to the North Pole. Both incidents raised protests from Canada, causing them to reaffirm their claim to the waters. Regardless of the legal status of the Northwest Passage, it remains to be seen whether it will be a viable route for shipping in the future. At best, it will only be ice-free in the summer, and surveys have reported that the eastern end of the route is too shallow for some large shipping vessels. Another waterway that could be used in future summers is the Northern Sea Route, also called the Northeast Route. It runs from the Iceland-UK gap along the Norwegian and Russian coastlines before ending with the Bering Strait between Alaska and Russia. In recent years, as many as 71 ships have used this route annually, but future large-scale viability will depend in part on the amount of sea ice. The British government has identified three major issues for Arctic shipping routes: lack of infrastructure and maps, severe weather, and the unfamiliarity crews will have of the region. Some estimates project the Arctic sea routes will be viable in 20 years. While cargo ships see an opportunity in the Arctic, so do cruise ships. Numerous Arctic cruises have sprung up in recent years, but they are not without serious risks. In 2010, a Canadian-owned cruise ship struck a rock that wasn't on any nautical charts. The passengers and crew were stranded for 2 days before an icebreaker came to rescue them. In 2019, another cruise ship with 800 people on board barely managed to restart its engines in time to avoid hitting a rock. Besides the safety risks, the sheer number of passengers can overwhelm communities the ships dock at. Many locals are critical of the cruise industry, saying it causes pollution and disturbs the natural environment. These problems also are not Arctic-specific. Other cities that are cruise ship hotspots like Venice have sought to reduce the number of ships visiting its ports. Local residents don't think the economic activity cruises generate balance the hassles caused by a large influx of people. Also, the Arctic is inhabited by many indigenous people, so visitors need to be sensitive to the fact that these groups have been living in the region for thousands of years and their homes deserve to be respected. Another economic opportunity in the Arctic is natural resources. Explorations by the U.S. Geological Survey estimate that the Arctic contains 13% of the world's undiscovered oil and 30% of its undiscovered natural gas. However, 84% of these resources are located offshore. The region has vast energy wealth, but it is unclear if that wealth will ever be accessed. Financially, extracting this oil and natural gas will be incredibly expensive. For example, the United Kingdom has some of the highest oil production costs in the world. Like any future Arctic drilling efforts, the UK extracts most of the oil in its territory at sea on platforms. The inhospitable environment of the Arctic will only increase those costs. Also, there is a significant environmental risk involved with energy exploration. An oil spill like the Deepwater Horizon or Exxon Valdez spills would be devastating and, because of the region's remoteness, very difficult or impossible to clean up. And as many developed countries are shifting away from fossil fuels, it is unclear what the demand will be for oil and natural gas that will be very expensive to extract. Other minerals will probably be very attractive despite the high costs. Rare earth minerals are required for many electronics, from cell phones to fighter jets. Currently, most rare earths are mined in China, but Greenland is known to have considerable quantities of these minerals. The United States, which relies on China for most of its rare earth supply, has taken a keen interest in Greenland's potential regarding these important resources. The U.S. Geological Survey has visited numerous times to map where these resources are. The promise of these minerals has led to competition on this island of barely 60,000 people. The U.S. is trying to thwart Chinese influence in the North American territory, and Chinese companies are attempting to mine rare earths in the Southwest. Much attention was given to President Trump's desire to buy Greenland, but the U.S. has been trying for years to limit foreign influence so close to the American mainland. It blocked the construction of airports by Chinese companies, and now plans to open its first diplomatic consulate there. Such a pristine region also makes it a great place to conduct scientific research. Scientists are trying to determine how life, even in the smallest form, survives in such a harsh region. They also study how the climate and sea ice are changing. Scientists recently docked a research ship to the sea ice and stayed in the Arctic all winter to study the ice. The Arctic's weather and oceanography are important because they can affect weather outside the region, and any future shipping efforts will require a better understanding of the region's waters. The Arctic is a region with huge potential. It might unlock vastly shorter shipping routes, new resources, scientific discoveries, and new economic opportunities. However, despite the warming environment, significant challenges remain. Many powerful countries have territory above the Arctic Circle, and they have overlapping ocean claims. Settling these disputes will not be easy, and the Arctic countries will have to agree to a more extensive treaty system to work together in an orderly fashion. Even if summer sea ice continues to decline, Arctic shipping routes will still be inaccessible for most of the year, and drifting pieces of ice will pose hazards for ships without reinforced hulls. Current search and rescue infrastructure in the region is not capable of dealing with significant sea traffic and will be expensive to build. And a region with only 4 million people might not like huge spikes in population, such as when a cruise ship docks. Locals are unsure about the cost of tourism and whether it will be worth it. What also concerns them is the pollution that will result if both people and companies start pouring into the region. If any of these concerns is ignored, the Arctic might not reach its potential and opportunities won't come to fruition. Thank you for watching. If you liked this video, please subscribe.